Good evening. Today is day 9 of the cash rush. The cash rush is fast becoming a cash crisis. Now, on day 1, the government said you can exchange up to 4,000 rupees. On day 5, they increased that limit to 4,500. Today, on day 9, they've reduced that limit by half to 2,500. In fact, 2,000, not even 2,500. On day 1, the government didn't have any plans for the wedding season or for the sowing season. So families which had weddings coming up were left in the lurch. Today they've announced measures for families that have weddings. Today they've also announced some measures for farmers. It's coming 9 days too late, some would argue. The point is simply this. This is symbolic of what we as a country and we as a people are famous for, jugaad. Don't anticipate what the problems could be. It doesn't matter whether you know swimming or not, jump into the pool first and then you'll figure out whether you can swim or not. Is the black money crackdown, and the initial reaction was that everybody was welcoming it, is it now in danger of cracking up because of lousy implementation? India at 9 begins right now. There's no question of a rollback, even as queues get longer and patience runs out thin. No question of going back on demonetization, says Finance Minister Arun Jaitley, as the government once again alters rules on cash exchange at banks. Like I said, there's an easing for farmers as well as for weddings. You can now withdraw up to 2.5 lakh rupees if you can show that there's a wedding in your family.
Odi mein iska aadha bhi Pakistan ke aatankwadiyon ki wajah se nahi mare thi.
That is a statement made by the regional opposition. Atrocious, objectionable, anti-national statement.
Meanwhile, the fireworks continue in Parliament. The government and opposition face off in both houses. The government giving the demonetization clash another nationalism tilt. On day 2 today, Parliament is paralysed once again over calls for a JPC, as well as repeated requests for the Prime Minister to be in the House when the debate is happening. Meanwhile, outside of Parliament, politics galore. Mamata Banerjee and Arvind Kejriwal join hands against the currency ban move. The two address traders at Azadpur Mandi in Delhi, vowing to step up their agitation. Kejriwal alleges Modi's direct support to Vijay Mallya. And we'll be joined by a full panel on our guests tonight. Sudesh Varma, spokesperson of the BJP. Abhishek Manu Singhvi, MP and Congress leader. Raghav Chadda, spokesperson of the Aam Aadmi Party, Shankar Iyer, economist and author, and Sunil Alag, business consultant and founder, SK Advisors. That'll be our full panel on the show in just a couple of minutes. But up first, it's day 9 of the cash crisis, and with each passing day, a new measure is being announced by the government. Let's bring you up to speed with what are the new measures that were announced today. The new order is that the exchange limit, which previously was 4,500 rupees, has now been reduced to less than half of that, down to 2,000. There's a bunch of relief measures that have been announced. One, of course, is for farmers. Up to 25,000 rupees you can withdraw if you have a loan from a bank. You can withdraw up to 25,000 rupees. There's also panic easer number 2. This is for weddings. Remember, this is wedding season, particularly in northern India. If you can show that there's a wedding in your family that's coming up by showing an invitation card, then the parents, one of the parents of the bride or groom, can withdraw up to 2.5 lakh rupees for that wedding. Meanwhile, in Parliament, it was similar to what happened yesterday. Both houses adjourned early amidst huge uproar. The government has rejected outright for any response from the Prime Minister. The opposition has been consistently saying the Prime Minister should at least be present in the House when the debate is happening. Outside of the House, more politics. Mamata Banerjee and Arvind Kejriwal addressed a joint rally at the Azadpur Mandi here in the national capital. Both the Aam Aadmi Party and the Trinamool are united on this one demand. They want a rollback. Other opposition parties, particularly the Congress, for example, doesn't want a rollback. They just want better implementation of the scheme. Let's bring you up to speed with the biggest sound bites from the day today in Parliament.
Thus, नवंबर से 24 नवंबर तक 4000 रुपया तक के पुराने 500 एवं 1000 रुपये के नोट बदले जा सकते हैं। 15 दिनों के बाद 4000 रुपये की सीमा में वृद्धि कर दी जाएगी।
Business entities having current accounts, for them the limit has been increased to ₹50,000 per week. This will enable them to disburse wages to their workers.
Banks would take resort to use of indelible ink marks for disbursement of cash. Technology team is being constituted to popularize the use of e-wallets and to activate the recalibration of the ATMs and to see that the ATMs are activated as early as possible.
It has been decided therefore by the government to permit the farmers to draw up to ₹25,000 per week against the crop loans sanctioned and accredited to their accounts. For wedding ceremonies which are going on, up to 2.5 lakh rupees will be permitted to be drawn.
So there is our timeline from day one to day nine, how the government has been bringing in one new rule, one new measure with each passing day. Are these frequent rule changes an indication of the lack of planning for this big, big demonetization move? Joining us on our Talking Point panel, Sudesh Verma of the BJP, Abhishek Manu Singhvi of the Congress Party, Sunil Alag is business consultant, Raghav Chadda of the Aam Aadmi Party, and we're also joined by Shankar Iyer, economist and author. Let me start, Sudesh Verma, since you represent the ruling party tonight. You know, it seems to me that the government is winging this whole thing on a day-to-day basis. First, you said, you know, the withdrawal limit, the exchange limit would be 4,000. Then you increase it after 5 days to 4,500. Today, you've decreased it to 2,000. 10 days ago, you didn't seem to care much about the sowing season or the wedding season. Today, 9 days later, you are announcing special relief for wedding and for sowing. I mean, my point is, a big move such as this cannot be played by the year, played on an as-is basis, come as it seems basis. And that's exactly what the government is doing.
You see, it's a huge country. And you also know that it's a mixed economy. You also know that there are various forms of transaction which are being carried out across the country. The government is alive. Government is dynamic. We are reacting in a dynamic situation. You cannot expect the government to be static, that you have taken a decision you cannot change. And at the same time, when the decision was announced, a certain dynamic aspect of the decision was also announced, that the situation would need, if it wants, we'll change it. So we are changing it as the demand is arising.
Mr. Verma, you seem to look at it as dynamic. The man on the street, the man on the street thinks it's ham-handed. I mean, You didn't think this through.
No, not at all.
You know, explain to me why the withdrawal limit, sorry, the exchange limit was brought down to 2,000 today. I'm just trying to understand.
No, because the government felt that there is a need for more cash. So you need to give to everyone, because you have to ensure that everyone gets some money.
So there's a shortage of cash, right?
Business, there's a shortage of cash. There could be. The banks are bringing the system. We have already announced that there are more than 2 lakh ATMs that needs to be calibrated.
You exemplify what the problem is, because when the Prime Minister addressed the nation on the 8th of November, he was clear, give it, you know, 2-3 days and it'll be okay. Then the Finance Minister a couple of days later says the ATMs will take about 2-3 weeks to be fixed. Then we know that none of these ATMs have been recalibrated, and today we're on the 9th day. I'm yet to see an ATM that's dispensing either the 2,000 rupee new note or the 500 rupee new note. I mean, Abhishek Manu Singhvi, the government's intent may be noble, but we're told, we're told that the intent may be noble, but the implementation, I mean, the lousy implementation can screw up the noblest of ideas, and that's what is playing out over the last 9 days.
Look, it's a great thing for a government or any dispensation or human being to admit fallibility and do course correction. But when course correction becomes a synonym for ill-planned, unthought-of action, knee-jerk reaction, then there's a huge problem. I think you've hit the nail on the head. Number one, it's not the figures which matter. What matters is that this week it is 2,000, next week it is 4,000, who knows, the following week it will be 6,000, now it is 2.5 lakhs, tomorrow it can become 1 lakh. The finance minister said 3 days, the prime minister said 3 weeks, the prime minister says 50 days. The point is that this is complete ad hocism. You are making up rules, policy, like a Tughlaqi Farman on a daily basis. The real question it raises is, did you think it through step 2 to step 8? Or did you stop at thinking at step 1? Was there foreplanning? Was there... Let's assume secrecy. A lot of things are being avoided in the name of secrecy.
Okay.
Which secrecy did you think this through? Secondly, I can understand that in this current scenario, 4,000 is increased to 6,000. I find it bizarre to be told it's decreased to 2,000.
No, that's because there's a cash shortage. Suresh Verma admitted as much that there is a cash shortage.
Let me complete. That's the point I'm coming to. Normally, one would expect with the riots out on the street almost, 2,000 from 4,000 is ridiculous. Now, thirdly, it is an admission that you are short of cash. But let me remind you, sir, that every day our finance minister and Shaktikant Das are saying that there is plenty of cash.
Let me bring in Shankar Iyer as well as Sunil Alagh into this. I mean, the point that Abhishek Manu Singhvi said, we are being constantly told that, look, this is a war on black money. And admittedly, I mean, when the Prime Minister made the announcement, everybody welcomed it. Yes, need to have a war on black money. But the war lesson 101, Sunil Alagh, is you war game it from step 1 to step 10 to step 50. The fact is, today, or over the last 10 days, the government is basically sort of winging it. It's as a new day comes along, they're figuring out a new problem, and then the next day, the solution to that problem. And then the next problem, and then the next day, you have the solution to that problem. That's not how policy is implemented. Sunil.
Look, if you're asking me, yes, I am admitting, and I would think that they should have planned it a little better. The execution has not been as good as one would want it. Now the question is that if the intent is good, the nation should get together and say, all right, this is what you should be doing to implement it. You cannot have an AAP and a Mamta walking and saying, scrap it. There'll further confusion which will be created. And they are saying, I challenge you. They're challenging the whole nation. Mamta said, I am giving you a 3-day ultimatum. What nonsense is going on in this country to say one state can give an ultimatum to a nation? So the thing is, I agree, there is inconvenience and it should have been planned better. And the government is listening. Come up with constructive suggestions.
Okay.
Don't keep criticizing. But if the government is listening, you're criticizing it for listening. That is wrong. That's all I'm saying. This is ridiculous to criticize the government.
Let's get Raghav Chadha to respond to that. I mean, normally the Aam Aadmi Party earlier, and the TMC
are the only two
political parties that have asked for a rollback. The only two parties that have asked for a rollback are the Aam Aadmi Party and the TMC.
Yes.
My point, Raghav Chadha, is are you questioning the very intent of this move, that the Prime Minister's intent to fight black money, howsoever flawed the means might be, that itself was wrong?
Okay, so a couple of points. First of all, more than 40 deaths have taken place owing to demonetization. Weddings are in jitters, weddings have been cancelled, patients are being turned away by hospitals. There is a huge fall in the economic activity, in the trading activity. Farmers, carpenters, plumbers,
Raghav,
rickshaw pullers, those at the bottom of the pyramid are...
They've increased the wedding thing. Don't go on and on about what's happening.
Let him finish.
This is not a rollback.
Did I interrupt you?
Make a suggestion.
No, did I interrupt you? Why can't you hold your horses?
But I'm just saying, you heard it.
So
it's a broken record of our party.
You keep your suggestions to yourself.
give a suggestion.
Just let me speak.
That's all
yes,
I'm
please
saying.
Kindly, kindly
I'm
calm
one
down.
At a time, please.
I am
gentlemen,
saying that
time,
it was
please.
A move
please.
Which was not well. Give a proper
Mr. Jacob, Mr. Alag is the one. Let him finish, please.
Sunil, let him finish. Raghav,
why have you still not answered my question, Raghav? When you have people like these who only know how to shout?
No, one second.
I mean, can you please calm down, for heaven's sake?
He will not interrupt
you. I'm answering the question.
But please answer my question.
Oh, come on, don't get personal, Raghav. You knows nothing.
Kindly
you shout
shut
all
your
the
mouth
time.
And let me complete.
You shout all the time.
Sunil, let him
Mr.
finish, please. I'm humbly
shout.
Requesting you again,
and so
please.
Should I talk about the illicit money?
I'm listening to you.
Let me speak. I never interrupted when you were speaking. Calm down, have a glass of water. And try and learn to listen to the other side. Now, my simple point, Mr. Jacob, is that a number of people, those at the bottom of the pyramid, are suffering the most. Those at the top of the pyramid have not even, you know, felt the pain of demonetization. Now, the fact really is that you have a certain Mr. Reddy, a senior leader of the Bharatiya Janata Party, who got his daughter married off and spent almost 500 crores yesterday. And then you have people in Delhi and in other parts of the country who cannot even have proper wedding functions because they don't have money. So the larger point is that the intent of this government is also wrong. This demonetization scheme is not a permanent solution to counterfeit currency, and it is no solution to corruption or tackling the menace of black money. Now, the black money is not stored in liquid cash.
Okay.
Most of the black money is either stashed abroad or kept in assets like real estate, gold or bullion. So first of all, they are targeting the wrong people. Each man walking on the street or a rickshaw puller, if he has some amount of cash in his pocket,
at least there's about 6 to 7% of black cash. Now, I'm not saying that that's a large amount or a small amount, but the fact is that 6 to 7% of black cash is there, and that needs to be weeded out. You may have differences of opinion on the means employed, but let me get a quick response to that from both Sudesh Varma as well as from Abhishek Singhvi before I go to Shankar Iyer. Sudesh Varma,
just to take forward the point that you're making.
Okay, I got it, Raghav. Let Sudesh Varma.
How do you put 100% of the people's misery and
Raghav's point is that you are going to basically find a few black sheep. One sec. Sudesh Varma, Raghav's point is to find a few black sheep, you're burning the entire forest down. That's his point.
Jaka, this is not correct. They are trying to simplify the situation, and it is sad that the party that talk of fighting corruption is speaking in that language. More chaos has been created because of anarchic behavior of Arvind Kejriwal. Whenever he comes on the street, he tries to create anarchy. Or Rahul Gandhi coming to that ATM and trying to exchange rupees 4,000. You know what kind of chaos
was
created.
No, but answer his point. No, for 6% cash, why are you convincing 99% of the population?
Jaga, let me complete. Why are you convincing 99% of the population? Raghav Chadda, don't smile. You have not done anything to smile. You are only mocking at the common man you claim to represent. You see, the whole country has been eaten by termite.
I am smiling at the hollowness of your argument.
I see you did not have anything to say. So kindly listen to me.
Okay.
When the whole country is ready to cooperate, even at the cost of inconvenience to them, why are these parties trying
Sir,
to
please step out of your house and go to a nearby
scheme,
ATM and bank and see whether the country needs to cooperate or
not? Do you think that the Prime Minister of this country, while taking the decision, had not thought of these things? Do you really believe so? When the Prime Minister says, give me 50 days, he actually means that there would be inconvenience. But after this, there would be new rebirth.
Mr. Varma, one sec. Can I ask you one simple question? So are you willing to give an assurance tonight on the show to all the people watching this program at home? The Prime Minister asked for 50 days, right? After 50 days, there will be no queues outside banks. There will be no queues outside ATMs. Everything will be back to normal as it was before the 8th of November. Of course, without the black money. Are you willing to make that assurance?
Even less than that. Even less than that, Jaka. Not more than 10 days will be needed when things will be normal.
Okay, I'll call you back on the show.
Maybe before that.
I will call you back on the show and I will hold you to account for that. Okay? Shankar Iyer. The larger question is this. That today what you're seeing, and Mr. P. Chidambaram referred to this in his interview a short while ago to CNN News 18, where he said, what you're seeing right now is the immediate effect. The secondary effect you will see 3 months from now, 6 months from now, for example, in the case of farming. You know, it's sowing season. Right now you're seeing queues outside banks and ATMs. Everybody's been affected. But 3 months from now, you will see the effect of the farmer not being able to have cash so that he could buy seeds. That will be known in the harvest season when the Rabi crop gets harvested 3 months or 4 months from now. The point is, this is not just the immediate impact. There is a definitive medium-term impact, which seems to be getting lost in the whole, you know, pictures of people outside banks and ATMs. We are forgetting about the medium-term choke on the demand side of the economy. Shankar.
Well, Zaka, this is the largest such initiative anywhere in the world. And there is no escaping the human cost that this entails. Let me park a couple of figures with you. There are 6 lakh villages in this country, 2 lakh branches, 2 lakh ATMs, of which nearly 1 lakh don't function. You have around 2 lakh post offices. The demonetization has pulled out 8 out of 10 rupees from the currency in circulation.
Yeah.
That's roughly around 23 billion notes. To get an idea of how big this is, India's current printing capacity is 26 billion notes. And the entire capacity is not used, obviously, for 500,000 rupee notes. Only a third of it is used. If you look at the RBI's annual report for this year, the government had made an indent of 21 billion notes, of which roughly 12 billion were 500,000 rupee notes.
Okay.
Now, when you suck out 14.95 lakh crore out of the system, it will take time to replace it. Now, that is the size and scale and the magnitude of the challenge. Did they think this through? I don't think so.
Okay.
I think there were several parts that were missed.
Absolutely.
The timing, the fact that this is the second Rabi crop season,
yes,
cannot have been unknown. That industrial establishments pay salary around 8th and 10th could not have been unknown. That 45% of the economy is informal could not have been unknown. So the issue that we are looking at now is that all those who are in the government have one set of definition for the problem, and those in the opposition have another set of definitions.
Okay, caught in between are people of India who are stuck outside ATMs and banks. Okay, I'm sorry to interrupt, Shankar, but I want to go back to Abhishek Manu Singhvi.
Can I just get a word from him?
Because
let me forget about the parties.
Finish your point. Okay, 10 seconds. Finish your point, then I'll go to Abhishek Singhvi. Finish your point, Shankar, quickly, please.
So all the parties who are agitating, their first question to the government should have been, what is the roadmap? And the government's first answer should have been, what is the roadmap?
Okay.
And that is what the average citizen,
the middle class guy in cities and the farmer in the villages. That is the answer that he wants to know.
Okay. No opposition party is asking that question of the government, and I suspect even if they were to, I don't think there's a roadmap, because if there were one, we would have seen that play itself out over the last 9 days. Abhishek Manusungu, my question is this. You know, the success or failure of this is not going to be decided in a week or 10 days or 2 weeks. The Prime Minister said, give me 50 days. At the end of the 50 days, if these lines go, and we sincerely hope that these lines go, and the government claims that, okay, 14 lakh crores was the money circulation in 1,500 rupee notes prior to the 8th of November. After the 31st of December, let's say 10 lakh crores has come back into the banking system, 4 lakh crores people have not returned. So that's basically the black money that's gone. Wouldn't that then be a gauge of the success of this operation?
Firstly, let me tell you, Zaka, that rollback in the sense of revocation may be next to an impossibility, because it's now a scrambled egg. According to me, it's been a disaster not thought out at all. But it would be a bigger disaster to roll it back, because you'll be literally between a devil and the deep sea. The people who are already hit very hard will be left nowhere. So I think a rollback is not a feasible thing. You can't unscramble a badly scrambled egg like this. Second, and that's why the Congress has not specifically asked for it, the need of the hour is a healing touch, a palliative, a set of measures which will solve it. Number two, these estimates, these dates, these number of days are completely meaningless. They are pure guesstimates. They have no anchor in reality. Now, if Tirupur, where wages are not being available, if Ichalkaranji, if Coimbatore, if you suck out 86% of your currency and you lead to a huge fall in demand because salaries and other monies are not available in cash or kind for a long time, then has the Prime Minister gone and done the biggest self-goal and hit wicket of his time by possibly contracting GDP by half to 1%? Today, the President of CII, and thank God some association has the guts to speak up, said that retail would contract by 50%. This is not the Congress party saying. The President of CII said so. And Kirana shops possibly by 75%. The only time where without reason and without hyper runaway inflation, 86 to 90% of your currency is sucked out in one fell sweep has been by Libya's Gaddafi and Zimbabwe's Mugabe, to which illustrious Hall of Fame Mr. Modi seems to have added himself.
The Congress party the made the same point in done. Parliament yesterday, Dr. Singhvi, and you know what happened.
Place, the, no, one minute. I'm giving you facts. That was Hitler and Mussolini. I didn't want to say that.
Yeah, I mean, the similar point was made by the Congress party. It led to an adjournment of the House.
No. Mr. Pramod Tiwari used words which were held to be objectionable. I am not saying anything objectionable. I am giving you facts. I am giving you the fact that Argentina is the only other example with runaway inflation. Where have you heard that with no runaway inflation and no immediate reason? Now let's come to the crux of the matter. I'll finish in 30 seconds.
Okay.
On a common estimate, I just heard 2 minutes ago, 6% would be unaccounted black cash.
Yeah.
No doubt it's a good thing to catch even 6% black money. But does it not amount to catching your nose from behind your neck if you have to go for 6% and cause immense pain? Could you not have caught 20% black money by 5 concrete steps, catching your nose directly from the front and not from behind your neck?
No, but then so the Congress party... Let me finish.
Mr. Iyer gave you the figure for the mints.
Yeah.
The mints can never republish these notes in 50 days or 30 days. It's a pipe dream for anybody, including the Prime Minister, to think 50 days is realistic. In 9 days, less than one-tenth of the ATMs have been recalibrated. Less than one-tenth. So no. 90 days, if it goes on this pace... So what are these dates? They're all guesstimates in the air.
Okay. No, you made your point. My only problem with that is that the Congress party, you said, you know, why not directly catch your nose to get 20% of the black money rather than, you know, putting your hand around your face to get to your nose to get 6% of the black cash. But my only problem is what Sunil said, that the Congress party is not putting out suggestions, or any opposition party is not putting out suggestions or measures as to how to get to that 20% black money. You were in power for 10 years.
Why?
I didn't see any constructive moves by the Congress party to curb black money.
That depends.
Nor am I hearing it from anybody in opposition, for that matter.
One minute. That depends on whether you are an ostrich in the sand or whether you are looking at reality. The largest number of bilateral agreements under which exchange of tax information is happening, all of which benefit this government is getting but not acknowledging, 85 in number, were executed during the regimes of the UPA with Pranab Mukherjee and Chidambaram as a finance minister. Largest number of bilateral agreements.
Despite that, No.
Number one, you're asking what measures were taken. Last 4 days, we have told 20 measures as to how you can attack black money directly. And they don't have to be told. Everybody knows how to attack black money directly. Nobody suggests, have you in any country found demonetization as the principal measure for black money? And have you ever found in a country, I sometimes feel, that the Prime Minister, advised by 4 people alone, possibly even his finance minister was unaware till 1 day before, has not even counted the number of 1,500 rupee notes.
The only problem with that is, despite all these bilateral taxation agreements that have been signed, the fact of the matter is, just a few months ago, the government ran, I wouldn't want to call it an amnesty scheme, but basically a voluntary disclosure scheme whereby it was trying to repatriate some of the money that was parked in offshore accounts back into the country. They got a paltry 3,000 crores out of that. So the proof of the pudding lies in the eating. The point is, Sunil Alag, and I want to bring Raghav Chadha also back into the conversation, that, you know, Sunil is right. To a limited extent today, can we just play out what Mamata Banerjee and Arvind Kejriwal today said? Arvind Kejriwal made a dramatic allegation. He was there with Mamata Banerjee at the Azadpur Mandi, and he said this is going to turn out to be the biggest corruption scam in the history of India. And then he did not give one fact or one figure to back up that claim. Can we just play that soundbite out, and then I'll get Sunil Alag and Raghav Chadha to respond to that.
एक दो दफे आते हैं जब जरूरत हो तो, लेकिन जब मैंने देखा अगर फाइनेंशियल क्राइसिस हो गया, जनता सफर कर रहे हैं, तो कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन का रक्षा कौन करते हैं? पहले कहते थे अच्छे दिन आ रहा है, और आज क्या लोगों ने कहते हैं? घर घर में सो रहा है और आदमी रो रहा है, रोता है कि नहीं है? ये क्या 17 दिन का निशान है?
मोदी जी, अगर आप काला धन और भ्रष्टाचार खत्म करने के नाम पे देशभक्ति की आड़ में घोटाले करोगे तो घोटाले के खिलाफ लड़ने के लिए भी जान की बाजी लगा देंगे इस देश के लोगों के लिए। कई लोगों से बात कर ली मैंने पूछा, ये बताओ 500 का नोट खत्म करके 2000 का नोट लाने से भ्रष्टाचार कैसे खत्म होगा?
And he also said other things, Arvind Kejriwal, that this will turn out to be the biggest corruption scam in the history of India, without giving any facts or any new information that he may or may not have. So, Raghav Chadha, another shoot and scoot operation by Arvind Kejriwal. I mean, this scheme is barely rolled out into nine days now, and you've already alleged that there is corruption.
I'll explain it to you. Now, Mr. Jacob, if you would have heard Mr. Kejriwal's entire speech, you would have found that he not only gave figures and facts, but he also produced documents to ratify his claims. Now, first of all, you have stressed assets and non-performing assets in PSU banks running up to 8 lakh crores. A number of banks have reported that they will go bust if these loans are not made good or if the government doesn't pump in money. Now you have a scheme like demonetization, which on the face of it cannot permanently solve counterfeit money. It cannot solve corruption and is quite evidently cannot solve the massive chunk of black money that is being stashed abroad or in real estate, etc. Therefore, it appears that out of 14 lakh crores of 501,000 rupee notes in value that will be deposited back into the banking system, or maybe 11 to 12 lakh crores will come back, out of which maybe 8 lakh crores will go towards funding these banks, these non-performing assets. And what does this mean? And I would want to read out to you.
No, what do you mean funding these non-performing assets?
It is not Arvind Kejriwal or Raghav Chadda. I will come to that. It's the CAG of India. It is the CAG of India who in July 2016, with reference to these 8.55 lakh crore rupees, said a large part of this is transferred abroad and will never return. A significant part of these NPAs is fraudulently obtained. It's the CAG of India that is saying that out of this 8.55 lakh crores, a significant part will never return. Therefore, this money is perhaps being entering into the banking system to fund this.
Sunil also weigh in. Finance Minister clarified this in Parliament.
No, and lastly, just give me 30 more seconds before you go to Mr.
Arad. A write-off is not a loan waiver. It's not like that amount of money is just disappeared or the government forgets about it or the banks forget about it.
Zaka, as a chartered accountant, I will explain that to you.
Neither,
give me 30 seconds.
Neither
I'll
can
explain
the
that to you.
Neither can
That's
the government.
That's the world's most foolish argument I've ever heard.
Neither can the government.
I will explain it to you. Give me 30 seconds, please.
One second, Raghav. I've heard you. Hear me out. Neither can banks use this fresh infusion of deposits to write off NPAs or to balance off their NPAs. It's apples and oranges. It's two different things, Sunil Alag.
I don't believe this. I don't believe what Raghav Chadda is saying, because one has run companies. When you take the cash in, the cash remains with the banks. Whatever you want to do, you are getting the banking system in. I've agreed with Abhishek ji. He has made some very valid points on where this thing could have been better managed. But this thing of rolling back, he's an IRS officer, your boss, yeah. Roll back and cause further confusion? What a stupid suggestion.
No, you explain. You explain the NPA.
Explain the NPA.
As a chartered accountant, one second.
Okay.
Well, you explain it to me.
NPA part. One second. Can I just finish?
Yeah.
The NPA part. One second.
And what does write-off
mean? Raghav, you asked me to explain it.
Okay.
Can I explain it?
Yes. We're listening to you.
All right. Fine. Any prudent chartered accountant, and I have been part of many companies which are there, they tell you if an amount is not recoverable, it is better for you to write it off in your books, and doesn't mean you stop the claim. When the money comes in, that you get.
Now, if you're talking about
Mr. Maya and all, they are not in this country.
Let me finish.
Does a write-off mean? Please, Raghav, does a write-off mean that the money is gone? No, it's with the banks. I'm telling you, if tomorrow the common man puts money into the bank, he has a right to take it out. You take it out, one second, let's discuss two points. One is a point of the common man, which Abhishek ji has raised. We are not talking about, these existed even before demonetization. So the question was, what happened in America? Either the government pumps it in, inflation goes up. With this money, what is the benefit for the common man after 6 months? His EMI will come down, liquidity will increase, the money that you kept in the house will earn you 6% interest in the bank, but you have a right. Take it out and put it back again.
Okay.
You're putting it into the bank.
Okay,
Now, when the finance minister of India and Mr. Alag
give a suggestion,
once these loans are written off from the balance sheet, they are still recoverable. Now, please understand, you have an outstanding in your books.
Of
you
course
say
they
that,
are.
Yes, Zaka owes me 5
are.
Lakh rupees.
I challenge
once you,
you on
write that,
that they
off,
are.
Once you remove
they
it,
are recoverable.
Once you remove it from the books, it is not recoverable. Once you remove it from your balance sheet, it's an off balance sheet item. You cannot A, legitimately recover it, or you don't have the right to recover.
Abhishek,
and the other person has no requirement.
No,
no,
I don't think that's quite right.
You better get a lawyer in now.
I don't think that's quite right.
That is what a write-off means. A write-off from the balance sheet means
on,
that money ceases to be recoverable.
No,
and
I write off
is legitimately
accounting.
That is what a write-off means.
Dr. Singhvi, you want to
respond?
No, no, no.
I don't know which company is. I hope you checked
these
companies
like
you are chartered
accountants. I'm not an accountant. Neither am I a lawyer.
The accounting standards
I don't think the two add up.
You better step in and tell him.
Dr. Singhvi?
Teach him.
Dr. Singhvi? Is that right?
It's totally wrong.
You see, in law, if you are suggesting that a conversion of a debt into an NPA renders it irrecoverable, that would not be so unless the bank writes it off saying that it is barred by limitation. Now, what is happening here is, and I think probably the finance minister is right,
yes,
that they are transferring amounts which are not recovered or become sticky loans to a NPA account. That is not a write-off in
that sense.
No. Write-off means two things. It's a semantic problem. One issue is a write-off where you say it is barred by limitation, I've written it off, I can't recover.
Yeah.
Then of course it won't be recoverable because there's an admission by you in your balance sheet with a note. But the write-off, I think the finance minister is talking about, I think there he'll be right, is that when you transfer something to an NPA account or to an account where there's a sticky loan, unless you categorically write it off, it is recoverable unless barred by limitation. And therefore, it would be in a nutshell recoverable.
Mr. Singhvi, the finance minister, was replying to Mr. Yechuri's question of writing off these loans from the balance sheet. You have a situation where the loans are transferred from good loans to non-performing loans. I completely agree with you that when you transfer it from good loans to non-performing assets, that doesn't mean that you lose the right to recover it. But when you write it off as an NPA or from the balance sheet, you lose the legitimate right to recover that amount, and the other person has no legitimate duty to pay that amount to the bank.
I don't want to get lost in this. One second. I want to get around a quick closing comments. In terms of the big picture, I mean, how is this going to play out, not over the next 50 days, but how is this going to play out over the next 6 months? How is this going to play out over the next quarter, over the next year, the next financial year?
Right.
Can I just play out sound bites from Arun Jaitley, the current finance minister, about some of the measures that have been taken over the last 10 days? And I also want to play out Mr. Chidambaram's chunk, and I'll get quick closing comments from the entire panel.
कोई ना कोई तर्क ढूंढ लेना कि ब्लैक मनी और क्राइम मनी ये रिप्लेस ना हो. मैं बिल्कुल स्पष्ट कर दूं, जो आम आदमी पार्टी और तृणमूल ने कहा कि इसको रोल बैक करो, इसका कोई प्रश्न ही नहीं उठता. अननेसेसरी पैनिक इज बीइंग स्प्रेड पर्टिकुलरली बाय सम individuals, and I didn't expect chief ministers of one or two states to join in this effort. It is the prerogative of the government to decide who should reply to a debate. Bulk of the debate has already taken place. I have attended the debate, and the government will decide who will reply to the debate. As far as parliament are concerned, at day one we said we are ready for a debate. In the Rajya Sabha, the debate has substantially taken place, and the debate itself indicated that the opposition had very little to say. And I think, therefore, they developed cold feet and are now running away from a debate.
Now, we don't believe the Prime Minister is wrong. We know he's wrong. It is not based on economic principles, not based on economic facts. Let's take one by one. If you take a decision of this kind in the year 2016 and to immobilize and impound 86% of the note, did the RBI directors know about the enormity of the decision they were taking? I doubt it. See, what drives an economy is money. We are a monetized economy, largely monetized economy. We are not a barter economy. And if you suck out 86% of the currency in circulation, obviously it will bring the wheels of the economy to a grinding halt. Already, Tirupur, Surat, Ichal currency have all come to a grinding halt. Nobody's got money to pay wages. Nobody's got money to pay for this ancillary services.
Varma, 45% of India's GDP comes from the informal sector. Close to 90% of all transactions are cash transactions. Aren't you sucking the life out of India's GDP and the growth story by taking 86% of currency in circulation out of the market?
You see, in the short term, yes, we understand there would be some pains, but as I told you, that if you want to actually correct the system, because you see, what was the mandate for? The mandate asked any youngsters, they are actually very, very frustrated with the system. A movement came, a chief minister also came, but he was also stuck by the system. So it was incumbent on Narendra Modi ji to take steps that will restore faith in the system. I would like to respond to the substantial point raised by Abhishek Manu Singhvi ji that when 6% of money is black, so why so much of effort? It's not just so much of effort. It's a question of creating better system. Whether an Indian can say with pride, yes, he is very proud to be an Indian and he believes in honesty and integrity. So this is a festival of integrity. We expect everyone to celebrate. We expect all the parties to come on the street and try to explain the government position to people. We have our whole cadre, you know,
okay.
We also get our feedback and apply correctives whenever it is needed.
Closing comments, Abhishek Manu Singhvi, Sunil Alag, Raghav Chadda and Shankar Iyer. Do you see the offset,
well,
the short-term pain,
yeah.
Dr. Singhvi? I mean, forget about the next 50 days. I'm talking about how will this
See,
be remembered
you,
1 year
me,
from
let
now.
Let me tell you. Exactly. That's the relevant question. I think the pain is already inflicted. The pain will continue. Whether it continues for 50 days, I think it's closer to 4 months to 6 months, if at all we're able to solve the pain. Certainly
okay.
No less than 90 days to 4 months. But that part is now something which you can't roll back as far as that is concerned.
Okay.
Only the shock of the pain may subside at the edges as the time goes on. The real question is, this doesn't seem at all conceptually thought out. I mean, this is no next. I can even support it partly on the basis of fake currency and terrorism. And that too, provided the new notes have some very, very special features. But nobody will support it as a direct measure for black money, anti-black money.
Okay.
There are 1,000 things you can do. Take a simple example and I'll end on that. You are talking of a plastic currency, the Marie Antoinette example which came in Rajya Sabha yesterday.
Yeah.
It's very good to have plastic currency. Every day, why do you and I not use it easily? Because the contractor, the outsourcer, the plumber who comes to you, he begs and then ultimately you also find it easier to give him cash and not a card, because 18%, 15% VAT, service tax, falana, dhikad, everything has to be paid along with that. Reduce those taxes, you'll have a better plastic economy. But
no,
you haven't
so,
thought
so,
it
no,
out
no,
like
no.
That.
The government's argument is
cashless,
the
cashless,
government's
cashless.
Argument is in any case, since GST is going to come up from the next financial year, you're going to have one set of indirect taxes. Number one, number two,
that
and
happen
there's a lot of
happen.
There's a lot of stuff floating around about how the government
it.
Might
no,
have
no,
a rethink
that's
on direct
debate.
Taxes on the concept of income tax.
Zaka,
but I'm not going to
debate.
Speculate. All I'm
that's
asking is this.
Unless you have lower taxes, nobody will use cars.
Sunil Alag, 1 year from now, will we look back at this move and say this was either Mr. Modi's biggest political gambit and he won it, he altered history, or will we look back and say this was the biggest blunder that he made?
No, I think we look back and say it was a great move, because within a year, you will have moved from complete cash society to use the banking system. You talk to the owner of Paytm now. He's thrilled. You get the auto guys in Bombay who are on Paytm. How are you going to bring about this change if you don't do it? I agree with Abhishek that perhaps pain is there for the next 60 days. He's saying 90 days, fine.
Okay.
EMIs will come down. Interest rates will come down. People will invest more. So you can see the long-term gains already, but short-term, yes, I agree. There is some pain and it should have been better executed.
Okay, Raghav, quickly,
that's
please.
My point.
I've got 30 seconds to close.
Well,
but come up with suggestions,
okay.
Constructive suggestions.
Raghav, 30 seconds, please. Please,
40% of India's population does not have a bank account. So to say that in a few months, India will become a cashless society is, I think, living in fool's paradise. That's one. Point number two, whenever the government has taken or made a move which needs our support or which is good for the people of India, we have supported it, be it the Yoga Day, be it Swachh Bharat Abhiyan, or when saluted the Prime Minister when he carried out successful surgical strikes.
Okay.
But the fact really is that demonetization after 1 year will be remembered as perhaps one of the most ill-conceived, poorly managed and wrongly targeted moves, driven by knee-jerk reactions, which led to 125 crore people subject to utter dismay and misery. Lastly, let me also say that the Prime Minister and if the Finance Minister was in the know,
I've got it. Shankar, 10 seconds. Shankar, 10 seconds, please. Last word to you.
There is an underlying expectation in all the support that this demonetization has got in the social media and elsewhere.
Okay.
And that underlying expectation is that when the average Joe goes to get his driving license, his ration card, or the guy who runs a small shop and restaurant will not be asked for cash, and that all political parties will come up clean, come under RTI, and will have transparent political funding systems.
Okay.
Otherwise, we are daydreaming.
1 year from now, and we'll know. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for the conversation. Sudesh Verma, Dr. Abhishek Munasinghvi, Sunil Alag, Raghav Chadda, and Shankar Iyer. We've had you know, historic reforms in this country. I mean the 1991 crisis spurred us into liberalization. I remember when the courts ruled that seatbelts should be made compulsory, people complained. There was short-term pain. When the NGT said we should go green, you know, public transport starting from Delhi should go green, there was temporary pain. But eventually, it's through that pain that reform happens. And like I said, history will judge this move 1 year from now, 2 years from now, perhaps 2.5 years from now in 2019 when the next general elections come along. How will history remember? Was this Mr. Modi's biggest game-changing, history-altering move? Or was it his biggest political blunder? We leave that to you, the viewer, the voter. Thanks for tuning in. As we wrap up our Twitter poll, this is what the Twitter universe thinks. Are the government's frequent changes over the last 10 days indication enough that there was lack of planning for this demonetization exercise? 43% saying yes, 57% saying no. With that, thanks for tuning in. Good night.